welcome to issue 178 of Critical Encounters, a podcast about Marvel Champions, a living card game by Fantasy Flight Games. Here we take a good look at the most critical piece of the game, the encounter sets. We'll discuss those poorly understood characters, unfairly labeled villains, and their various plans to shape humanity and benefit the planet, as well as those so-called heroes intent on thwarting them. I'm one of your Groots, and with me tonight is Groot, and also Groot. Hi, Groots.
I am Groot.
I am Groot.
I am Groot. Daniel, Groot. Groot, what is on your mind tonight?
I guess I'm no longer speaking Grootese.
No, we can't talk Groot the whole time.
I guess that would be.
People got to figure out what we're doing here, but yeah, well, let's do that other thing we always do. What's on your mind tonight?
Gratitude, Steve. Gratitude is on my mind. We have another Patreon thank you and another job to dish out, I guess. Because, Steve, you've identified the need. Once we sort of maybe accidentally trashed the lair a little bit when Mike was gone, and we built that greenhouse.
Yeah.
Well.
Victory Garden. Yeah.
The Victory Garden. Yeah. Well, that's kind of a lot to manage. And the stuff that's growing there is a little wonky. So we needed a poisonous and toxic greenhouse keeper. We're out of gloves. Oh. And N95 masks, but
oh god, I didn't hear that. La la la.
Yeah, well, I think we still have some safety goggles around the mic, so don't worry. But I'm sure that our new greenhouse keeper won't be harmed during the harvesting of any plants that we might need. But who is this? Who is this masked, or actually not masked, greenkeeper?
Green thumbed patron.
This is Anthony Pereira. Thank you so much, Anthony, for your support on Patreon.
Yeah, thanks so much. We really appreciate it.
Steve would never get to Italy without you.
Wait, what? I'm going to Italy?
Woo! I'm sorry. I mean, could never pay the hosting fees without you.
Thanks, Anthony.
That's more along our budget. So I still haven't got the septic pumped or anything, but, you know, it's okay.
Well, yeah, most of the funding is, I think, going to restoring that one wall.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, we really do appreciate our patrons.
We do. Thank you so much.
And in fact, you guys know that this is a patron voted on issue we're going to do.
What? There is such a thing? This is madness.
Yeah. So some of our patrons, sometimes we have done one of these, a patron poll. We asked them, what subject matter would you like us to do for either a secret dossier or a Taskmaster School for Gifted Villains, and they all decided that we were going to do this. So this is the very first one of these. Thank you, folks. And we're gonna talk all about our most favorite tree folk, Groot, right?
Yeah. We'll do some backstory, and we'll talk about how to beat the snot out of him.
Oh, good. We'll see if his bark is worse than his bite.
Oh, that was so good. Proud of you.
But
yeah, you can't leave me alone with a bunch of puns just hanging out there.
Oh,
low hanging fruit for me.
Oh.
So.
Mike, get to the story time.
I want to hear more.
Yeah,
you got to root out some more of my terrible puns.
This is awesome.
Yeah,
father of two, right?
Three.
Three.
Three. So,
yeah. So we have. This is our origin story. This is actually not the first plant-themed episode we've had in the last month, because you guys did that nice interview with Xander, who brought along the Black Tom card with his creeping willows. Aren't they cool?
Pretty awesome.
They're awesome, yeah. Really good.
I like that set a lot.
I would love nothing more than to regale you all with fine tales about Black Tom, Cassie, and his friends. But alas, you fine listeners voted to instead have me talk about the Dirty Rapscallion. You'd rather I spoke of the sneaky undergrowth, the floral fraudster, coniferous con artist, our arboreal adversary, Vin Diesel.
A celebrated Dungeons & Dragons player, I might add. I am
Groot. So what?
I like these nicknames for our character here. It's great.
Yeah.
These are good.
Yeah.
These are good.
Yeah, I love how they didn't actually have to use CGI over top of Vin Diesel for the movies.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah.
Spitting image. Anyways. Okay, let's hear about some Groot. Groot is best known as a member of the Guardians of the Galaxy, which I think everyone knows by now. He actually first appears decades earlier in the comics, in 1960, in a Monster of the Month type story in Tales to Astonish number 13. Now, don't concern yourself with that version. He's a very different character. He could talk. You could see it on the cover. And since then, the lore's kind of gone back and forth over whether or not that's even the same Groot. I'm Groot.
Yeah, you said that.
I remember that.
Yeah. And
compared to the other Avengers, or Guardians rather, how is that like one of the earliest or what? I can't remember how old
the other pretty ones early. I know like Gamora was reasonably early too, but I don't think she was 1960s early.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, there was like a whole Guardians of the Galaxy that are completely different people way back. Martin X and Charlie 23 and all those guys.
We've got the whistle guy from the movies.
Yondu,
yeah, him.
I'm very popping, y'all!
The whistle guy.
I don't keep track of the allies, you know that.
Mike, former whistle guy.
Oh, yeah. Too soon? Okay. Too soon. All right. Anyway, so there's sometimes his species is called Groot, so it gets really confusing when you start talking about the really far backstory about what Groot people are talking about. So we're just going to ignore that. We're going to talk about his modern incarnation, which appeared in the mid-2000s with a couple storylines that eventually led to him joining the new Guardians of the Galaxy, headed by Star-Lord. And this is the one we all know.
Okay.
Groot's backstory is a little inconsistent. We'll learn that later. He claims to be the last survivor of his species. This is the Flora Colossus from Planet X, capital of the Branch Worlds. No, I don't know what Branch World is. It's probably just a pun.
Branch.
It's Monarch, although it's kind of weird to call yourself that when you have no subjects. If no trees fall in a forest because there's no trees left. Is it still a forest? I think not. So Groot has this annoying habit of dying for the team and regenerating through a splinter.
We are Groot.
He gets blown apart. He gets incinerated. You name it. Every time. There is a splinter left behind that the heroes cultivate into a new young Groot. Lucky for us villains, the heroes aren't smart enough to consider cultivating multiple splinters to create multiple Groots. So at least we have that on our side.
Could they do that?
Is that possible?
I'm sure there's going to be an Enter the Grootverse at some point where that happens. I mean, what's stopping them? It's just they just take a splinter. He literally gives splinters before he gets incinerated sometimes, and then they cultivate him from that splinter. No, I don't know how his consciousness transferred.
Mike, you mentioned earlier that he claims to be the last survivor of speech. Like,
when he speaks,
people understand him, right?
Oh, yeah. So, a note on that. So, the Flora Colossi actually can talk. They are said to be able to talk. But their larynxes are so stiff because they're trees.
Hmm.
Think about that. They have the ability to talk, but they're trees.
That's right.
Someone made that up. Yeah. Okay.
Okay.
So they can only make a few grunting noises.
Didn't stop the Ents.
Yeah, I know.
Okay. Well.
Hence the variations of I am Groot. So they can't talk, but they can say that.
I am Groot.
Whoa!
Hey.
You got some acorns on you, kid.
Now, if you have a good ear, you can understand him. And both Rocket Raccoon and Star-Lord are able to communicate with him. Until now, the Guardians had a run-in with the Gardener, which is the best player card in the game, by the way, and all would-be heroes should include it in their decks. So they start out as enemies, but as the storyline goes on, Groot ends up saving the Gardener because Loki poisoned him, and Groot purges the poison and something, something. So the Gardener repays Groot by relaxing his larynx, so now Groot can talk, and it's really weird and unsettling.
Je suis Groot.
I don't know. It's bizarre, right?
An impression?
Well, I know in the speech bubbles, it's white text on black background. But he talks in sentences. The only thing that's off is that he talks in the third person.
Okay.
Which, you know, he's...
Yeah, that makes sense.
Yeah.
They don't keep that for very long, I would guess. It doesn't seem like it would be very popular for that.
Oh, God. These are just...
Sorry. Keep them coming.
These are getting better and better.
Sorry.
So, why do we as villains care about this talking twig? Because of his crimes against the galaxy, which include, number one, aiding and abetting Rocket Raccoon, whose catchphrase, I will remind you, is, "Blam, I murdered you." Two, being said raccoon's best friend, which perhaps is not so much a crime as showing a severe lack of judgment.
Mm.
Three, impersonating royalty. That's right, Groot is not a monarch. He isn't even the last remaining Flora Colossi. He is only a dirty liar. You see.
But you said that he was the last.
Yes, but many, many episodes ago, when we were talking about Ronan, I told you guys about this lovely little miniseries called The Annihilators.
Yeah.
Where Ronan is actually one of the heroes. If you go to the very back of The Annihilators, there's this little cheeky sub-story that they just threw in the back. And it's Groot and Rocket kind of after Star-Lord dies, because Star-Lord always dies and comes back like everybody else. But before the quote current, more current run in the mid-2010s, there's this period where there's no Guardians of the Galaxy. So it's kind of fleshing out that side of the story. So in that storyline, Groot returns to his homeworld to aid an insurrection by the maintenance mammals. By the way, aiding an insurrection would be crime number 4 for counting. So the maintenance mammals. So you're thinking, what are maintenance mammals? These are the denizens. These are the denizens of the forest of Planet X that maintain the biome for the great Arbors. In return, the Arbors offer them highly rewarding permanent employment with no pay. So Groot is anti-labor, everyone. Now, he is captured during this insurrection. He is tried for impersonating royalty and for treason. They said it, not me.
There you go. Okay.
He is, of course, found guilty and is chained up on a remote island inhabited by mechanical woodpeckers. Rocket comes to his rescue, wherein a fight ensues between the underground resistance and a posse of assassin clowns. Seriously. Okay, you're now, thinking right now, Mike.
You have recently written up something like this for me.
Yes, clearly.
Tricked me.
Clearly, tricked Daniel. Me
just like this.
Daniel must be playing a joke on you in writing this. No, it is in this comic.
I read some of this. Yes, I remember this.
Yes.
Oh, my goodness.
It has to do with Rocket's backstory, where he used to work at a therapy facility where there were clowns, and it's kind of turned into this weird fascist place. And the clowns are now trying to get their little therapy animal back. So, but of course, they're assassins. Sure. That's not important right now. But anyways, the clowns try to burn down the forest, but the forest creatures stop them. So in gratitude, the Arbor Masters grant Groot a full pardon. So to reiterate, Groot is rewarded for helping stop the thing that Rocket Raccoon made happen.
Okay.
So there he is. That's him.
Well, I will say this. The fact that he's sort of a Prometheus figure, being like mechanically woodpeckered for eternity is awesome.
Pretty good, yeah. Pretty
good. I just love that. I hope.
Why are they mechanical?
Like a year or something. Well, so they can keep going. And so, like, you know, I mean, like, you know,
it's not like there aren't living things on here.
Well, does Groot have little bugs crawling around inside him? Because woodpeckers, that's why they peck wood. So maybe Groot's not loaded with grubs and stuff. So they have to be mechanical or else they'll starve on them.
Right.
Oh, but I just love that vision. Is it? Please tell me there's like hundreds of them on him.
They don't show him being swarmed. They show them kind of guarding him, waiting for him to move. But apparently he's just like packed. The idea is to slowly torture him over time. Yeah.
That's delicious. Wow.
I want to know who built these robots. Okay.
I want mechanical woodpeckers in the game. They should be in Groot's nemesis
pack. Nemesis set. Yeah. Okay. All right. Yeah.
Do you think we can make some?
Wait till Christmas.
We could spruce up his nemesis set with them.
Nice.
God, you're so good tonight, Steve. This is incredible.
Hey, I learned all these when I went to elementary school. So. I'm sorry. I'm sorry, everyone.
No, this is so good. This is
fantastic.
You know, puns like sarcasm reveal intellectual capability. So this is good.
Mm-hmm.
It's good. Okay. This just means you're really smart.
Oh.
Yeah. Well, we do these things, these weird backstories on the heroes for a reason.
Yeah, this is not a routine sort of episode. So we do have to talk a little bit about the hero cards. And Groot came with protection in the Galaxy's Most Wanted box. So way back, whenever that came out, he didn't have his own pack, right? He came in that box, and we'll have to go through, we'll look through some of his cards here and kind of talk about the ones we like, the ones we don't like, dangerous ones for the villains, and that sort of thing. But I think Mike should give us the hero card. What do you think?
All right. This is Groot. In Alter Ego, he has 4 recovery. He is outlaw traded. Do you see it? Hear that, everyone? This is not hero, this is outlaw. He has a hand size of 6, 10 hit points, and the growth spurt action, which is place 2 growth counters on Groot to a maximum of 10, limit once per round.
Okay.
You guys all know what his catchphrase is.
I am Groot.
And then if you flip him over to his hero form, he has 1 thwart, 2 attack, 3 defense, guardian traded, Flora Colossus ability. He has a forced interrupt. When Groot would take any amount of damage, remove that many growth counters from him. For each growth counter removed this way, prevent 1 of that damage. And his hand size is reduced to 5. So that's him.
I like that he has to do it.
Yes.
It's kind of neat.
Yeah. Sure. So his alter ego side is really just a way to facilitate his hero side, right? To put out tokens. I was a little surprised he only had 10 hit points while other heroes have more.
I guess because he really has 20 hit points.
Maybe.
Right?
Yeah.
Or on turn 1, he'll have 12.
Yeah.
So.
I mean, he's got interesting stat line, a 1-2-3. So you're like, okay, I can build protection with him. Oh, I can remove tokens, prevent damage. He doesn't suffer from a lower hand size like sometimes the big guys do.
Right.
Because he doesn't have the 10 hit points. All right. So his whole thing is revolving around these growth counters, right?
Yeah, pretty much.
Okay.
Whoop-de-doo. What do they do?
Yeah, what do they do? Danny, why don't you tell us what some of his growth counters or upgrades could do?
Sure. Well, he's got some entangling vines. This is a 1-cost upgrade. It is a superpower. It is a hero interrupt. When Groot makes a basic thwart, remove a growth counter from him and exhaust entangling vines, and Groot gets +2 thwart for that thwart. And it is a brain resource. A nerd resource, as we call them. I am Groot is the flavor text of that one. I like it.
All right. So then, like you said, another one of these, Vine Shield, is a 1-cost upgrade with superpower. Hero interrupt. When Groot defends against an attack, remove a growth counter from him and exhaust Vine Shield. Groot gets +3 for that attack. I am Groot, he says. And there's a third one, Mike. What's that one?
This is Vine Spikes. Another superpower. Hero interrupt. When Groot makes a basic attack, remove 1 growth counter from him and exhaust Vine Spikes. Groot gets +2 attack for that attack. Hmm. We get it. You're Groot.
Nice. All right. So this trio of upgrades, you remove a growth counter. He gets a bonus to a basic power, whichever one it might be. Right. So he could, with this, go to a 3 thwart, 4 attack, 6 defense. 6 defense is no joke.
It is no joke.
That's hard to punch through, right? I mean.
Oh, yeah, for sure.
Yeah.
Yeah. You need to be some crazy Venom Goblin.
Yeah. Ronin, that kind of thing. But you do have to use up those very precious growth counters. And so far, we haven't seen any way for him to get new ones in hero form. You'd have to flip back, get a couple, come back, that kind of thing, right?
Now, when are we going to start talk strategery about beating up on Groot?
Oh, pretty soon.
Soon. I have a couple thoughts on this.
All right.
Okay.
Yeah, let's go through a few more cards, and we'll come back to this.
Yeah,
how we can cultivate him or cue Groot down. He does have this Lashing Vines, which is his last upgrade. 1-cost superpower hero response after Groot uses a basic power. So this is any basic power. Remove 2 growth counters from him. Exhaust Lashing Vines and ready Groot. I am Groot, he says.
Yeah.
So he's got 4 upgrades, 3 that boost his stats, and if he makes a basic action, and another that lets you ready if he takes a basic action. Okay. But there go all his growth counters, right? I mean, a couple moments goes by, all his growth counters are gone. So he's going to need to get some back. How is he going to get some back?
Well, I'm sure he's got some annoying event.
He's got a couple. He's got an event, and he's got a support.
Okay, what are those ones, Mike?
So he's got Fruition, which is, I believe he's got 2 copies of Fruition, which is a 0-cost event. Superpower. As an action, place 2 growth counters on Groot to a max of 10.
And it's important to note, Mike, that's an action.
Yep.
I have the form. Not alter ego, not hero, just action.
Yeah.
Yep.
Okay. unlike Fertile Ground, which is his support card, which is a location. It's an alter ego action only. Exhaust Fertile Ground, place a growth counter on Groot to a maximum of 10, of course, and draw one card. Okay,
gets a counter, draws a card. It's sort of like double action. That seems like cheating, but okay.
Okay.
Yeah, I know. Okay, so those are, we have his ways to get growth counters back. There's going to be one more that we talk about later. But now we have his big events. Steve, do you want to read the first one?
Sure. The first one is...
I am Groot.
Three-cost event. Superpower. Thwart. Hero action. Thwart. Remove threat from a scheme equal to the number of growth counters on Groot. It's also a nerd resource. And there are two of them. So if he has three growth counters on him, he can thwart for three, right? If he has no growth counters on him, he can thwart for zero. At a three cost. This card is great for the villains. Yeah, spend all your resources and remove one threat. Go for it, dude.
That's doubling his thwarting capability.
Yeah. Obviously he's going to have an attack one, Daniel. What's the attack one going to be?
Well, that is... It's an attack superpower. Same idea, but for two cost, hero action attack, deal damage to an enemy equal to the number of growth counters on Groot. And that is a Fisty resource.
And there's also two of those.
Okay.
I guess that one's better because it's cheaper. So, I don't know.
It could do 10 damage.
It could. Yeah, but it does lack overkill. It does lack piercing. So, yes, it is. Is it the most damaging event in the game? Potentially.
Potentially, I believe it is.
Yeah.
Well,
it's usually the, well, no, Captain Marvel can go 10, right?
With the
fully
upgrade.
Charged up.
Yeah, but when they get like really big like this, they tend to knock back some of the special keywords and abilities.
Yeah, I mean, Iron Man has his Repulsor Blast where you like discard cards, and that could hit like a 13 or something if you're super lucky.
I wouldn't know, Steve.
Yeah, well, yeah, he cheats the most, so. All right, Mike, there's another one here, though.
Yeah. This thing is only one cost for some reason.
We are Groot.
Superpower, hero action, remove up to four growth counters from Groot. Choose that many friendly characters and give each of them a tough status card. That is bonkers. Just bonkers.
That's, yeah. I mean, four that's counters.
Doctor Strange on a stick.
Yeah, I guess that's why there's only one. Oh, don't get sappy on us, Mike. Right, that one didn't really fit, but that's okay.
You needed to wait for Mike to tell me how much he loves me.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Which usually happens like once or twice a show. So, all right. I want to know more about the Root Stomp.
Well, this is Root Stomp.
Is that Thor? No, who's under that? It wouldn't be Thor. He's a good guy. But who is that?
It's probably a Badoon. If you look up at I Am Groot, there's two Badoons with similar looking armor and colorations and stuff.
This guy looks like he's having a bad day.
He's having a bad day. Yeah, read that card, Daniel.
So there's three of these. Three Root Stomps. It's a $2 event. Attack, superpower, hero action, attack. Deal 5 damage to an enemy. If this attack defeats that enemy, place one growth counter on Groot to maximum of 10. Okay.
All right, that's all his cards.
Okay. Have you guys played a lot of Groot?
I played some Groot.
Okay, a little.
I played some Groot. Did you have fun playing Groot?
I did and I didn't, depending on the type of build that I had.
Okay, interesting.
You're trying to push something. What are you thinking?
I'm not trying to push really anything. It's just sort of like I spent a lot of time trying to figure out what is the best number of counters on him and how much time do I spend in Alter Ego. I actually found him kind of delightfully complicated, is the wrong word, but thinky. Right. And situationally thinky. And I like any hero where you're encouraged to be an alter ego a lot.
Right.
And so I appreciate that about him. And I also appreciated the design of making it a forced interrupt that when he takes damage, these things go away because you could really cheat.
Yeah.
Right. And so as villains, our job is to somehow hit him all the time with little things. So what kind of villains do that? And we can answer that question later. I know you guys should talk about playing Groot. I enjoyed the experience of playing Groot much more than I thought I would because I don't necessarily care much about the character in real life, if that makes sense. You know, like, right. I don't have like a theme need to play Groot.
Right. I do want to get back to him again now that more cards have been released. I have three decks I'd like to talk about.
All right. I think, yeah, you'll have to. I've tried that he looks like he should be a protection, right? He's got these prevent damage. He has this huge defense. I think I found the most amount of fun I had with him was when I played him in Justice because I was flipping so much, and then I had to do thwarting, and his thwarting is not great. It can kind of be there. I mean, you're really dependent on getting his upgrades out. If he, like Daniel said, if he takes some ping damage, here's a onesie, twosie, whatever, his cards don't pay off.
Yeah.
I mean, I really tried to play him in protection, but I don't know. I was stumped.
Oh, good, Steve. I found that when I felt this way about Spider-Man too, like from the core, is like, well, because his defense is so high, you don't have to play him in protection,
right?
And that's how I feel about these high shield characters. They're just like, why would you go green with them? They don't need it.
Like high shield and low other stats, right? Like if you play him in protection in solo with the cards that were released at the time, yeah, you run into trouble because if you want to attack or you want to thwart, you're either waiting for the big events and hoping you have the resources,
hoping you have the counters
and the counters to do it. And until then, what, you're tanking, protecting your growth counters until that comes off, like constantly exhausting yourself, or you're defending using what, lashing vines to ready yourself at a cost of two, and then using your basic powers at a cost of one, which is a really expensive way to just hit the way a lot of heroes normally hit, and then having zero counters left for those big, big payoff cards.
And a solo Groot trying to adapt to, you know, spending it, what, 40% of the time in alter ego to get those counters, to get the payoff for the thwart card.
Yeah.
There's already too much threat. So, like, I don't think he could ever keep up, right?
I don't think so. That's basically the game I didn't like. Now, I have seen Protection Groot work really, really well in multiplayer.
Sure, I'd see that.
You guys know Rowan, friend of the show, Rowan?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, she gave us the Enchantress lore.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And the Enchantress lore.
That's right. Forgot about that one.
She was on two shows.
She played Protection Groot, where because there were two other people on the table, she didn't have to thwart. She didn't have to attack. Okay, now this is awesome because she can defend across the board. She can use her amazing defense events to help protect people across the board. She can give out tough cards like it's candy, and she doesn't even have to defend her own attacks because she could just sap it on her growth counters, and all she has to do is keep the growth counters up. That's it. So it worked remarkably well when you didn't have to deal with the rest of the game. Now, with that said, there's a couple decks I want to highlight. One by Drew, which I believe you guys know Drew, right? Right?
Oh yeah. Okay. Why am I not surprised? Yeah. You have a deck from Drew that works.
Yeah. Why highlight a deck from Drew? Just like, okay, here's the best.
Well, it's to point out, like, he basically did a build that was like it's the Porcupine build. I've done it with Captain America. I've done it with Ghost Spider, where you use all the events and things that trigger off of not taking damage. And he doesn't take damage because if an enemy hits him for 10, okay, he defends 3 and 7 growth counters come off. He hasn't taken any damage. So hard to ignore, always goes off. So enemy attacks him and 3 threat comes off the main screen. And you can do funky stuff like that with retaliation. Like, it doesn't have built-in retaliation, but you can still give him electrostatic armor. And if you wanted to, you can give him the flow like water if you wanted to do it that way. And Drew's got one that's basically built around hard to ignore. But more along the lines of what Steve was saying, I think you hit it on the head. Like, he's really good in Justice. Because Daniel says, yeah, he's got 3 defense. You don't need it. And if you're going to alter ego, yeah, you're going to need to port. So Nocturnal Animal has a deck called The Best of Growth Worlds.
Oh, nice.
Nice.
Red.
Yep.
Well, Steve, you must love it already.
I do. I don't care what it does.
Yep. So what's great about this is that there's a lot of Justice events that allow you to thwart while being exhausted. And that's the whole thing, right? He can exhaust to defend, and he can still use his events to keep the board going. And then with his leftover tokens, he has them for his payoff attack events.
Right.
Okay.
I should probably say the Drew's deck was called The Giving Tree. It was all about tough.
Okay.
That just made me sad.
You said you had 3 decks. I want to hear the third one before I have more to say.
Oh, the third one was Rowan's.
Oh.
Multiplayer version. Yeah.
Okay, good.
I don't remember if it was published, but that was a stick of it.
we talked about, and Mike wasn't here, we talked about Miles Morales with Sanyo and how great Miles is, and the villains better be terrified of him. Mm-hmm. I feel like, in general, we don't have to worry a ton about Groot. Like,
I agree and disagree, but say more.
Yeah. If he's very, very susceptible to those growth counters, not having them, there's only three cards in his deck that give him... Okay, three cards that generate growth counters for him. There's the Root Stomp that will do it, but he has to defeat something. So I guess those count. And then you're flipping to Alter Ego. Any kind of damage done to Groot in any other form, though, pulls those off. And if you don't get the right upgrade that he wants, he's kind of stuck. Right? If you want to be doing the thwarting or he's not readied, you can't use any of these abilities that count on your basic power when you use a basic ability to exhaust this thing, I find are not as scary as some of the event-based folks or upgrades that don't require to use a basic ability where it's just exhaust this thing and do something. So I feel like he's sort of like, if we were to rank him on power scale, I think it's just sort of in the middle, maybe a little lower, unless he has some sort of big spike of attack like Mike was talking about. So
here's where I'll push back only a little bit. As a villain, I don't mind seeing Groot unless Groot comes with two or three friends.
Yeah, okay.
Because I think he's an incredible support hero that makes everyone better around him. And he's oddly flex, right? So he's sort of a B minus at everything in the game, except defense, where he just sort of stands there and can take punches.
Yeah, he's Mario from Mario 2.
Yeah, and I think someone playing him, like, so I think a good Groot player, like those, I feel like the Entangling Vines and the Vine Spikes and the Vine Shield, they're kind of trap cards if you put them all out. And I think,
right, yeah,
I think you decide as Groot, I'm going to be an Entangler Groot this game, or I'm going to be a Shield Groot. Like, it depends on what you need. You play one of them out. Because I think, other than thinning your deck by having them all out in front of you, and maybe, you know, fodder for the basic card that takes your stuff away.
Oh, yeah.
You're not ever going to use two of the cards for that get rid of a growth counter to bump up your stat. Probably.
Like, maybe in an emergency.
In this game, I need to get +2 thwart. Every once in a while, I'll need that. And that's why he's dangerous with buddies, because he can fill in gaps everywhere.
Okay, I could see that.
You know what I mean? So that's where he's effective. Yeah, I would never, ever play Groot solo unless I was looking for a super challenge.
Yeah, I have played him solo, and it's like you get two or three minions out, and I'm trying to defend to keep my growth counters up, and I can't punch back. You know,
he's way too easy to control.
Yeah,
alone.
Yeah.
You can hem him in pretty easy, and it's over quickly.
I have a thought
behind the scenes. Go ahead, Mike.
I had a thought on defeating Groot. This is a three-pronged strategy. The first one is to write some letters to FFG and get Deft Focus eroded.
Yeah.
Because all of his payoff cards are superpowers.
All his upgrades are superpowers.
Upgrades too? Yeah. That card is bonkers economy in Groot.
It's very good for Groot, yes.
Yeah.
I think he only has one card that's not a superpower, and that's his Alter Ego support. So.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And you hit it on the nail. You hit the nail on the head there, Steve. Heavy reliance on growth counters. And because he's got that low thwart stat, I think you need to load up on lots of indirect damage and lots of scheming. Because that indirect damage will just sap that those counters. That's how you have to do it. You can't break that defense, so don't try. Just throw out... And all those characters that, you know, deal indirect damage, like deal damage to every character or deal 2 damage...
Mm-hmm.
to the defending character, things like that.
I got two things to say, Mike. Number one, I don't think Death Focus is that big of a deal in his deck. Yes, it helps all of his cards, but I don't think all of his cards, like, it's not about the cost of them or getting a discount on them. If you can control the growth counters, his big money cards, I don't know, they don't do very much. And the Death Focus is going to pay for these upgrades, make them free, but then they sit out, so you're not paying for them anymore. I don't know. I don't think it's that big of a deal. And two, I want to start talking about what aspect are we most terrified to see Groot in. And for me, is based on what you just said, Mike, about how indirect damage as a way to like ping the growth counters off him. That's why I don't like to see Groot in leadership.
Oh yeah.
Okay.
If he's got his buddies take the indirect and then he'll just defend minions and never lose anything.
Well, it's worse. He can give his minions tough counters.
Yeah. I mean, he can. Yeah. So a Groot leadership might be the only way to solo.
Groot Justice can work.
And maybe Groot Justice, I suppose. But you still need to hit something every once in a while. And yes, he can, but.
Okay. So here are my thoughts in a nutshell.
Nice.
Everything we've been talking about is which aspect is he good in? Why would we play a bunch of allies? Why do we need these justice cards? We didn't even mention aggression, protection, because his hero kit is not that exciting. Other heroes were like, the hero cards make the deck, and you're playing an aspect sort of along for the ride. I think he's the opposite. You have to have a good aspect going in order to make his hero cards useful or have a payoff. I think that's what makes him like for me. Like,
oh, that's interesting. So do you feel like it's the counters themselves that sort of constrain what his 15 cards could be in a way?
I mean, every single card,
it's a self economy that like eats itself.
Yeah. Every single card requires growth counters. Every upgrade you spend a growth counter for, every event is based on the number of growth counters you have.
Sure.
A couple cards give you growth counters. So if you're out of growth counters, you're doing no hero. You're not using any of his hero cards. You're just using the aspect that you've played.
Got it. Yeah, I see that.
Yeah. So I think that's where it, like, he falls off for me if I was to be a hero and want to play a hero.
Okay.
No, yeah, I think it feels more like a Weeping Willow to me than like this Mighty Oak. So.
So I guess is our consensus that, you know, as villains, we look out on the field of battle, and if we see Groot,
we see a solo Groot coming at us, we're like, yeah, whatever. I have a chainsaw. Come on.
See, even if we see him with a bunch of friends, we might know how to contain him a little bit, even though he's going to make that trickier. We can contain him, but he makes the other people better. I don't know. I see what you mean, Steve, about like, you're just not going to get all excited to see those 15 cards because they do the stuff they got to do.
Yeah, and other heroes who utilize tokens seem like they do it better or faster. Like War Machine, you have a bunker that you can beef up. He flips. He gets 5 ammo counters in Alter Ego. Groot's only getting 2. Ironheart can get her little tokens like crazy with every event, right? So those are a couple heroes that rely on their token, their internal economy, and they can do it a lot better. So maybe they learn from growth. Maybe they learn from Groot. And,
well, do you think it's a thematic win, though? I mean, I do.
Oh, yeah, it's great.
Right?
It's really cool.
Yeah.
The art all looks great, and the idea behind it, I think, is awesome.
And he showed up with, Rocket.
Rocket. Oh, yeah. Oh, theme-wise, I think it's fine.
As a dynamic duo in the deluxe box there, in that campaign box, they went pretty well together, right?
Yeah.
And
Rocket's a character who is... gotten immensely better with the whole repurpose scheme, right? And I haven't seen anybody say, oh, you know what we could do now with Groot? Right. You know, just 2 cards that make him amazing. I haven't really seen that. So
I guess it's because he is sort of powerful. It's just quietly, boringly powerful.
Yeah.
And potentially not powerful.
Right.
Right? Like, I mean, I certainly have never seen a 10 damage, I am Groot.
Yeah, that's a lot of.
But if you can load up on turns. That and actually do it one game, like that's the thing you talk about that game.
Right. Yeah.
So I don't know. Yeah, I guess Groot's rarely going to be like the main part of the story you tell after the game. You remember that time that I took a growth counter off and got too smart?
Yeah, I'm curious. Yeah. I'm curious how many growth counters our listeners have managed to get him up to.
So. How many growth counters have they spent in a game with Groot? That'd be interesting. Because then you get a real idea of like his statistical power.
I think I gotta give him another shot. I think he's better than we're giving him credit for.
Yeah,
I just want to try him with some of the new cards.
Yeah. I'm just saying as a villain, I see him coming and I feel relief. Relief. Sorry.
Well, let's fix that for him, Mike.
Okay. What else do we have to say about Groot? Anything else, Mike?
I'm Groot.
Nice. Yeah. Okay. His performance in this game is a little wooden. Yeah, I'm running out. I'm running out of options.
No, this is the fact that you sustained it as well as you did throughout, Steve. I'm impressed. Impressed.
Well, if that's all we have to say about Groot, I'd like to branch out a little bit here and do a gang up segment.
Well, sure. We haven't had one of those in a long time.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. There's a podcast out there. It's new about Marvel Champions, and I found it on accident. And I think everyone should go and listen to these guys. It is called The Winning Hand, a podcast about Marvel Champions one card at a time.
Wow.
Every episode is dedicated to a single card, which they discuss and debate at length. They give you tips and tricks for deck building with the card, how they like to use the card, what decks they put it in. And it's hosted by Boom Guy, Lazy Titan, and Keiko. So,
that sounds awesome.
Yeah, it's they've got, as of the recording of this episode, they have 8 shows out. So they are brand new.
Nice.
They have good audio. They have a good rapport with one another. They're fairly positive on the game, yet not crazy fanboy positive, if you know what I mean. Like, they have their criticisms, but they're not, it's constructive.
So they're more Mike than Mustafa?
Yeah. Well, yeah. So, The Winning Hand, I will put a link to one of their...
That sounds great.
They're on every podcatcher and YouTube and all that kind of stuff, so...
And speaking about having, you know, fuel for that fire forever...
Mm.
How long is an episode, Steve?
Actually, they go kind of long, like 30 to 45 minutes, because...
On a card?
On a card. Well, what they do is they sneak in a little bit of... what have we been playing? And they talk maybe about their current deck, and and they may sidetrack on their current deck a little bit, and then they'll get at the card and they rate the cards: art, theme, power, fun. They talk about mechanics and where it'll fit into a deck.
Gotcha. Okay.
Yeah. So, yeah, they could go on forever, right? How many cards are there? So,
well, everybody go check that out. That sounds fantastic.
Yeah, go give a listen,
Mike.
Thanks for that.
Where can the good folks find us to tell us how much they love or hate Groot?
Yes, and I also want to know if Steve missed any puns. You can email all of them to Daniel at criticalencounterspod@gmail.com. We are Critical Encounters on Facebook, and you can find our YouTube channel or Patreon by searching for Critical Encounters Podcast. And on Discord, we are Vardane, Big Foam Loaf, and Wandering Too. If you like our show, tell your friends. If you don't like our show, tell your enemies. Groot, take us out.
He's relieved you don't want him to. He hates us. On anyone, not just himself. That's right.
No! No!
You guys know what Groot's favorite drink is?
No.
It's root beer.
He ferments himself?
Well, I don't know. Don't needle me about that.
Oh.
What's his favorite Canadian city? Montreal?
Oh, yes, yes, yes.
Okay, I'll let it go. I'll log off now.